Speaker this afternoon is Greg Hodges, a BSc from Queen's University. Actually, an interesting story. Greg was he was in fourth year, right? Yeah. I don't know why this thing is. He was in fourth year when I arrived to teach at Queen's, so he was my first student ever. I can't really say I taught him everything I know, but. I arrived and he was leaving, basically. We had 1 year of overlap. Did I actually teach you a class at all?
Actually, I sort of audited it because I'd taken it the year before.
That's right, yeah, yeah. Since graduation, he's been 14 years with junior and major mining companies as geophysicists and chief geophysicists. And then for the past 20 years with CGG and its former versions as chief geophysicist. Greg's talk is, it's a short one. And he has a co-author, Tanyo Chin, right? Lawler HL helicopter heli TEM test results.
Right. Thanks, everyone. I always seem to get the after lunch session or time slot here, which I sort of characterize as nap time, so I won't be offended by anybody. But yeah, we flew HeliTEM over the Lawler deposit there in 2012, partly just to see what we could do, see if we could get it with HeliTEM. This is sort of a Reader's Digest version of the talk I've given before at BCGS, but so I'll skip most of the geology because you've already seen a lot of that by people who know it much better than I. But there's the deposit, there's the ground geophysics that led to the discovery. So we've got two very big conductive zones and a general conductive area around them. The only name I know for that south one is the South Bullseye. But it was important in planning this, because what we wanted to do is, first of all, is model it and see if we're going to get anything. So there's multiple zones. I characterize it as a pancake stack of zones, dipping shallow, lots of conductivity, coarse grain pyrite, sphalerite, thick zone of intense hydrothermal. That's kind of important. We'll get back to that a little later. And it's in quite a resistive area. Anyhow, it's a bit of a tough target. It's over 500 meters deep, beyond 600 for a lot of it. It was detected with the extra large ground EM system, but wasn't detected by any of the airborne time domain EM that had flown it before. So we wanted to see if HeliTEM would detect it. We had a lot of options that we had to decide what was going to be worth trying. Of course, transmitter power, you want as much power as you can get. But there's always a trade-off between your transmitter power, the pulse size, and the repetition frequency. So we looked at the base frequency. We could try 30 hertz or 15 hertz. Problem with 15 hertz is you got less stacking. You've got half as many samples, so statistically isn't as good. But it is good that you've got more time to play with for each pulse. We could try anywhere between 4 and 10 milliseconds pulse. A longer pulse gives you more low frequency energy into a strong conductor, but you lose off time, in the sample time after the pulse. And then how did we want to process it? Of course, we ended up throwing everything at it. So the first thing to do was model it, and I just went with 800 by 500 meter conductors, small dip, 200 Siemen conductivity, conductance based on the decay constant that we'd been given. And we modeled it basically with all the pulse widths and all the frequencies, all with a 2 million amp meter squared dipole moment, which is what we get. Here we went up to 2.5 million with the slightly slower pulse. We could get a little higher. And that's what the data looked like as modeled. You can see you're only dealing with about 10 picoteslas at the best response. That's a 6 millisecond pulse. That's 15 hertz B field. But of course, you're going to model something, you've got to be honest about it, in which case you've got to add, in this case, what I would characterize as pessimistic noise. So that's the noise that was added to it. And you can see when you add the noise to it, it becomes a pretty tough target. Also did a 10 millisecond pulse. And you can see much, a little bit stronger. If you look at the 250 microsecond in red there, we've got a little bit stronger response because we do have more low frequency. We also have, if you look on the right-hand side, a much lower response from the, basically from the overburden, the very top layer. It's so resistive, there's not much host geology response except that overburden. So by going to a longer pulse, we get a little more energy into the strong conductor and a little less energy from the overburden. And so we can add noise to that as well. So in actual fact, as you see from when you had the pessimistic noise, it looks pretty dubious. Weren't sure if it was worth doing, but fortunately, energy overrode common sense. We did it anyways. 15 hertz wasn't significantly better, as you saw. There's some advantage to it, but you do lose the stacking noise. So we decided to try it anyways. Tests were carried out. We seem to have a slightly older version of my talk here. I'm not sure how, so if I skip a slide or two, forgive me. But we went, the base, sort of base configuration was 30 hertz with a 6 millisecond pulse and about 1.9 million amp meters squared is what we could achieve out of our transmitter. Flew a line over the Lowler deposit itself, had a look at that, liked it, and then went and flew the rest of it. And this was the very first line. This is the raw data from the field. The dashed line is where we flew, and then you can see the EM profile. I've sort of outlined in black the character of the profile. So you can certainly see the noise. We're down close to a noise limit, but you can also certainly see a broad response across it. And if we turn that into connectivity using our differential connectivity algorithm, as well, you see quite a strong response across it. There's some noise around, but it's quite consistent. And then there's as well the conductive graphites to the north there. That's what it looked like in section. So again, this is now looking, the dB by T, which for anybody who doesn't know, tends to show you the weaker connectivity. Doesn't show it really well, although it did, if you look closely enough. The B field, which is enhancing the strong conductor, certainly is much better. And we've got quite a broad response there. And as well, that little blip you see on top of the data, that's a power line right across the top. And of course, there would be a power line right across the top of it. And there's three lines there. We can see the power line response. We can see, again, a very consistent response. We're down working close to our noise level, but we have lots of, we have signal, and it's very repeatable. Looking at slices now, so time slices, so the very early time on the bottom right, the very late time on the bottom left, we see fairly consistent. You've got to remember that with time domain EM and a very resistive geology like this, depth and time don't directly correlate, so we're not necessarily seeing a lot deeper. We're just seeing the stronger conductors in the late time, and that's what we see. So, and if we look at conductivity, same sort of thing. It does isolate a little better into the two conductors in the very late time in the top left. Just a close-up of it, so there's the Lowler deposit, just sort of pencil outlined there, and then the south bullseye. We were a bit confused at the time, which was Chisel Lake, so you'll forgive any labels which are just stuck in Google Earth there. Whole stack of sections, so all the lines that you see marked in red across there have sort of put the deposit stack about where it is for depth. Again, depth and time don't correlate perfectly or pretty well with in such a resistive host, but it worked much better than you might have than we might have expected. So we've got good stack, and of course the deposit is wider than just one line, so it goes across multiple lines. So each line across it, especially for that depth, won't see it tremendously different until you get a few hundred meters offside. The south bullseye is here. That's the further south anomaly, also very good connectivity section, good beefy, a little bit stronger response actually than Lawler. And interesting too, I won't say that picks out the dip exactly, but it actually does match the dip in the area. So the connectivity sections usually aren't that good in this environment, but it certainly seems to have worked here. And then three lines across it again, good response for a repeatable line to line. And then the conductivity sections, and there's that apparent dip to the whole thing. Then we tried the 15 hertz, so a 10 millisecond pulse width, so much wider pulse width to get more energy into the strong conductor, and a little bit less power because of the amount we were putting into the pulse. That's one line there, so we've got a response quite similar here, and a good conductor, or in the conductivity section there in the middle one. And as well on the bottom, we're looking at the power line monitors. That's telling us, yeah, there's a power line there, which we see as a bit of connectivity near surface. Same thing again there, next line over. So good connectivity at depth and that power line response. A power line is almost always a conductor. You may or may not see the noise from the 60 hertz in the power line, but the line itself usually has a ground wire, which is a conductor. So comparison of the 30 hertz on the top and two passes with the 15 hertz, You can see not a lot of difference. There is a little bit more noise in the 15 hertz, just as we would predict. And as a matter of fact, it's very close to what you'd predict from the statistical difference, about root of two higher noise. Another important thing is the two passes with 15 hertz in opposite direction just show you that there's not a significant change. Some people make a deal about the asymmetry of our system. It's not that asymmetric, and especially for a target this deep, doesn't make a big difference. And there's the conductivity sections for those multiple passes. So the 15 hertz, it detected the louder deposit, just like the others. The noise level is just what you would think. There was no significant increase in the signal, not a lot, but there was a bit more noise. Also, the important thing, 15 hertz, well, the 30 hertz, you've got 16.6 milliseconds to work with. 15 hertz, you've got twice as much. But as you can see in the 30 hertz, by the time you get to those last channels, there's not a lot of signal left. So the second 16 milliseconds you have after what you'd get in 30 hertz, there's not much signal there anyways in this particular target. So it didn't really lend anything to detectability. Very different, perhaps, in conductive host geology, where you've got to give time for the current to go to depth. So, good results. We're happy with it, but of course wanted to play with it. We modeled it. And we did two modeling schemes, if you want to call that. One is discrete plate models, so using either the program plate, which is a free space, or plate in free space, and Leroy Air, which is a plate in conductive host. We tried those. Plate models are good because if you can assume your target is plate-ish, then they give you an idea of the geometry. You can actually get a sense of the dip. You can get a sense of where it is. And good for stacking up multiple zones and trying to distinguish them. So it works well if you've got some good geology in particular. You can try to match your geology better. It does assume it's a good match to plate-like conductors, which may or may not be true. And the inversion can be difficult if you've got multiple plates or so many degrees of freedom, they can start to go all over the place. The other thing we did is the finite element or arbitrary three-dimensional model. This was done at UBC using their algorithm. Its main advantage is there's no model dependence. You don't have to assume anything about the geology. And in that respect, it's a little more hands-off. That you can let it run. However, it doesn't give you back the geometric information. It doesn't give you a number called dip, for example. So here's the plate modeling, and we started knowing what sort of things were down there, so we started modeling various plates in here, and then shifting the plates around and playing with the size until we got something close to what had been reported in some of the earlier geological studies. So that's zone 10, zone 20, a little deeper down, same conductivity. These are a bit bigger than what's reported. The difficult thing in this, though, as always, is the geophysics doesn't see the economic sulfide. It sees all the sulfides. It sees the stockwork. It sees everything around it. So there's always a difficulty, and I'm always telling geologists, you've got to tell me all the sulfide there, not just the economic stuff. And then we modeled the power line in there and some other connectivity that wasn't reported to try and get the signal levels up now. I've learned since that, yes, there is more connectivity in the area than just the economic zones. Didn't take it much further than that. For one thing, we ran into this bit of a difficulty. If you look here, I'm showing the data in a blue line and the model in the red dots. And you can see, although my amplitudes are pretty good for these results, the decays are different. And the case on this case, in this case, excuse me, dB by T on the left is decaying too fast. And on the right, the B field model is decaying too slowly, which means I'm somewhere in between. I can't do anything to my connectivity that will solve both of these problems. I can make it longer or I can make it shorter. I can't do both. Why is that happening? Well, probably we're running into a model-to-reality conflict. Real conductors aren't smooth plates. They don't have an exponential decay. As you can see here, it's a little faster in early time. It's a little slower in early time, a little faster. They're not exponential decay. There's interactions between the plates affecting it. Variability in conductance across the plate. So you can only go so far with the plate model, and then the fact that geology isn't a mathematical plate starts to get in your way. And then to repeat this from the geology, we've got thick zone of intense hydrothermal alteration underlaying it, stringers, all these sorts of things. So as well, my plate models don't cover all these other things that are there and affecting my signal. So then we tried the 3D inversion. This was the mesh laid out, a 3 by 3 kilometer fine grid, and rotated that way. So now we've got to sort of rotate ourselves. You can see where the north arrow is. That's what the data looks like on the mesh. And if we look at it in 3D, and I'll zoom in on that. And so what I've done is I've taken away all the resistive geology and just shown the conductors. And you can see right away Lawler and the South Bullseye conductor there. I'm showing it right up to surface. There is some extra connectivity here to the north, I've been told. Yes, that's sort of known. That's that stuff there. Oh, okay, sorry. Now I've taken and sliced it at the top of the conductor, so sliced off that near surface geology. You can see it was all near surface, the stuff to the north of Lawler. Zoom in a little bit, and now here's what we're seeing for the connectivity at the depth of the targets. And if we want, I'm going to take it now and turn it this way, sort of to look along, sort of in a little more in cross section of them. And that's what we see there. So we see Lawler and we see the South Bullseye. And just as we did in the differential connectivity section, we see the same dip to the top of the conductor down. So that gives me the confidence that certainly the top that I see in the differential is matched by the more advanced processing here of the 3D inversion. And now I'll take it and slice through it. So I'm just looking at Lawler, something like that. I've got the surface there. You can see the cut through the plate or through the conductor. Cut off the stuff at the top, and there we're left with the response that's in the area of the Lawler deposit itself. And that's pretty, when you interpret 3D inversions, you would say, yeah, that's a pretty good match. If you're not familiar with what 3D inversions are showing you, you would say, well, the one's a blob and one's plates. The connectivity's there, it's in the same place, it has fairly much the same distribution. This is the limitation of 3D, it doesn't give you a geologic description, but it puts the connectivity where it should be. So the results can be modeled to match geology within the limitations of the model algorithms. There was some excess connectivity around there, which I've already mentioned. The original modeling, if you recall, underestimated the signal too. So there's more signal, more connectivity there than the geological description that I had would define, which is fine. And there's always possibilities to do more modeling on that. The other thing we didn't fly yet is gravity. We've got Pester Adam shales there to get out there and fly the gravity gradiometry. But we did want to know if it would work, so we took the ground gravity and basically upward continued it to see what you'd get from airborne gravity with the Falcon gravity gradiometer. And you'd get, as you might expect, a little bit weaker signal, but when you're looking at something 600 meters down, moving your gravity system 100 meters higher doesn't make a big difference in your distance to the target. So there's not a lot of loss in signaling going to airborne in this case. So the results show that it worked. 30 hertz, 60 milliseconds was probably the best all around, and it is for a lot of other things, but 15 hertz definitely worked. Long wavelength, low amplitude anomalies across the deposit, just as you would expect. There are challenges. It's a deep target, has a low amplitude response. There's a lot of culture in the area, and of course, getting worse every single day. So we would like to do some more modeling. I'd like to thank Hud Bay for permission to do this, and Dikung Yang at UBC for his inversion, and then Chen Yu Chen in our office for the work he did processing the data. Thank you very much.
Questions, anyone? Sergio, stand up.
No, I don't like to use white noise because our noise isn't white. I basically just take an old survey, and I might scale it up or down, depending how pessimistic. Take the noise component out of another survey and just paste it into this one.
Is there another way of flying twice or three times the same line and extracting the noise from it?
That would be another way, yeah, a little more expensive to do that. I'd rather just take a quiet line somewhere. The other thing I'll do is just use a combination of a half a dozen different sinusoids with little bit different wavelengths, because people use white noise, but the noise that's in the tenth of a second wavelength is not a problem to us that you would get in white. You've got to look at the sort of the noise that would be there in process data and the noise that's in the wavelength of the target. So that's why I prefer to use real noise if I can get it.
Is this your deepest test of this Helitem system?
It's the deepest target we've picked with Helitem so far.
Okay.
I'll be honest, there's not a deeper target that we've flown and not detected. So it's the deepest thing we've tried to detect, and we did detect it. It's sort of. In the inversion, we had to use the last ones. To get that strong conductor at depth, you really got to. Dickon would have to answer for what he did, but I used all the data. At 30 hertz, it's a 4 millisecond pulse, so about 10.6 milliseconds after the pulse.
Okay.